I found something interesting yesterday because I was reading, you know, the chapter on the labs, and I found something that I want to show it to you. I don't know if you want, you know, like an introduction. Okay, so I can show it to you just to give you a head start, and then you can, you go on. But this was really interesting. Okay, let me share my screen. Okay, you see my screen, right?
Yeah.
Okay, let me see where it is. Aha. Okay, so these are the chapter 13, right? The labs exercises from the book. Uh-huh. Okay. And as you can see, you know, they use base R. They don't use the tally models. They don't use, you know, anything fancy. Even dplyr. The dplyr, they don't use it. They use base R, and that's fine. Okay. Sometimes, you know, you want to, you know, get a taste of that. Okay. So here in the first exercise, which is the review or hypothesis test, right? We're dealing with a t-test function. And one of the things that I was kind of curious, it was to see, you know, if there was something there in the R ecosystem, the R packages library, to try to make it easier for the summary to be, to try to get it more communicative, okay? Because this is the summary of the, for example, the one sample test. This is a summary, and as you can see, you know, you cannot put that in a report, okay? You have to explain what you're doing and then kind of verbalize it. So I found this very neat package called report, okay? Which what you do is that you insert the t-test or the tests that are, you know, available for that, you know, for that function that accepts that, that the function can accept that. And then you put in parentheses, you put a report. Uh-huh. And interesting, it gives you basically a narrative of what the test is.
Great.
Okay. So for example, here, the output is effect sizes were labeled following Cohen's 1988 recommendations, okay, which is the Cohen D factor. Then it explains the one sample t test is testing the difference between X1 with mean 61 and mu zero, okay? And suggest the LFA is positive, statistically not significant, and medium. So this is very, very good. And one of the things, you know, if you see this library, you know, this package, it's not only circumscribed to the test itself in base. You can put a summary there also. For example, a summary of the data frame, you can put it there, and it will give you a narrative of each of the columns and everything. So very interesting that this this package report. Okay, I recommend that anyone that is listening to us and everything, that check it out, because it could give you some efficiency in terms of when you are doing some reports and you're trying to explain what is the t-test and what are you trying to do. And the other one, which complements this, okay, because you have the report, but sometimes you have to visualize, you want to visualize what the t-test is doing, right? So there's another library called ginfluence, okay? And what this library does, as the report library, instead of doing the narrative, it gives you the visual representation of what the t-test is doing. So for example, you put again the t-test, in this function, ggt test, and then you get this visualization, which tells you that the statistic that you are, you know, the results from the parameters, from the mu zero, et cetera, falls within the 95% confidence interval. So in other words, you don't have enough evidence to reject, right? To reject the null hypothesis. So we kind of, you know, we have to kind of implicitly accept that, you know, that mu is not different from, you know, from our parameter, okay? So this is pretty neat, okay? Especially the visualization, because coupled with the report, then you have the whole narrative, right? In the report, you have the whole narrative explaining, and then the visualization, and it's easier to, communicate. Okay. So this is really nice, really nice. Okay. So that's my those are my two cents for this chapter. Okay, so remember a report and GG inference. Those are the packages. Okay. And maybe in the chat I'll because there was a video that I watched yesterday. Let me look at and then I'll post it in the chat. It explains more about the report function.
Okay. So I'll share my screen.
Sure.
Or you have more to?
No. I just look at it and then, you know, I just at night I just, you know, input those and I saw that it was working. I said, okay, you know, it's ready for prime time.
Okay.
Yeah. So you can now, you know, continue.
Let's go back here. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now I was doing some things. Okay. So last time. General resources and then ISLR. We can even open up Emil website. But for now, right. We had this thing to see and we left off last time, which is the lab.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it's better if I need it. I love all the things. In the meantime, I have a look at this Emil Tidy Models Lab. Okay, multiple testing.
Yeah, it's still in progress.
Right.
Yeah.
I see. I remember now.
Yep.
Ah, because I was running a model. That's why. But I'm going to stop it.
Okay.
I'm going to. Okay, so last time where we were, basically, if we have a quick look at the book as well, which is here. Let's see. Multiple testing. Jim, we lost Jim.
I know. he must be busy, so you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's see. In the meantime. Okay, this is the lab. Okay, so here they use the base R, okay? And the first thing is the things that you nearly, so you show already, so the t-test, because you need to make the t-test, and then it will release one p-value. Now, what's happened is that we have more than one p-value. So to replicate this environment, this situation, we need to replicate a certain number of hypotheses. So when we had just one hypothesis, that the mean were equals to each other. So the difference in mean was zero. Now we have hundreds of this new hypothesis. To do this, we do replication 100 times. Mm-hmm. And then we set this on a certain threshold, well known as a less than 0.05. So if the our p values would be lower than this 5%, so we can reject the new hypothesis. So what's happened now? With a table, we can see that from random replication of 50-50, we have 40 where we do not reject the null hypothesis because the null hypothesis is false. We don't reject the null hypothesis, but 47, the null hypothesis is true. And then we reject the null hypothesis for 10 when it's false and 3 when it's true. So, and these are the cases where we have true positive, true negatives, and false positive and false negatives. Let's go back here, see what's happened. Okay. Yeah. So this is multiple testing. And we need to go forward to the lab. Okay. And this is the lab. Mm-hmm. And there we go. Okay. So now we are here and say that we make a matrix. Maybe if we do this on R, we can see what's happened. Let me go back here. And we see that the lab sampling approach. Okay. Okay, so if we do these things, so we're starting from making calling this X matrix. Okay, this is our X matrix, which is this one here. Then, oops. What we do is calculating a t-test, and we have the result saying that the mean of X is 0.6, and the p-values is greater than the 5%, so we don't reject, and we accept. So now, let's advertise that we have hundreds p-values. For now, we just set them on zero. Then we run a for. Let's do this. Okay. In a way that we can fill up the vector that we have just created. So now we have this decision vector and this other one with rejecting and one with not rejecting. So when we do the table, we can see that the table is just as the one we have seen. Now, our X now become a matrix. because we don't have just one vector, but we have a matrix. Okay, so now this is our X matrix. And again, we do the four and the decision as well as before. Now we see things different. Because this simulation basically results with a high number of type 2 errors. And as you see, this is where the null hypothesis is false and we do not reject. So basically it's type one error. So we fail to reject. And this is type two error. So the hypothesis, null hypothesis is true, but we reject it.
Federica, I think the confusion matrix is kind of, you know, reverse, okay? Because since you have the null hypothesis is true, right?
Yeah.
And you do not reject, those are the true positives, right? 48, the true okay. positives.
Yeah. Right? Okay. So, yes. Yes.
So,
yes.
So if you go down, then you see that the hypothesis is true, but you reject the HO under two instances. Those are the type one errors. Okay. The type one errors, which are the true negatives. Okay. The percentage of true negatives. Then in the other one, you reject the new hypothesis is false and you reject the new hypothesis. So you have 40 instances and those are correct. Those are your false positives, right? FP. Then you have null is false, okay? That's the actual, you know, the true number, but then you do not reject. So when that happens, you have a false and negative, right? And those are 10, and those are associated with type two. So the matrix is kind of backwards. Okay. You have your true on this side, on the right side, and your false on the other side. Okay. Instead of the true on the left side and false in the right side. So it's kind of reverse. Yeah.
Let's repeat these things. So the new hypothesis is false. Mm-hmm. And it's false, and I rejected.
Yes.
So I'm doing right.
Correct. Those are your false positives. Okay, your false positives. In other words, the null hypothesis is false, and you're predicting that you should reject the hypothesis. So that's that false is positive. Okay, FP. Okay.
Okay. When.
Okay, so,
Then the null hypothesis is false, and I do not reject it. So correct. I fail rejecting the null hypothesis.
Mm-hmm. So those are false negatives, and that is associated, those false negatives are associated with the type two errors. Those are your type two errors, okay? Because remember, the type one is the one when the null is true, but you reject. Okay, remember, people are innocent, but we find them guilty. Remember that. You know, I always remember that, and it puts me in the right place. Okay. The hypothesis is true, right? It's true, but I reject it. Okay. So that's a type one error.
Okay. Why this thing is reversed? It's not just
it kinds of, you know, because you're using a table, okay? It kinds of, you know, spaces that way. Okay, so you have to be careful. And I have seen this, okay. You know, I have seen this, for example, if you work with H2O or auto models, for example, the confusion matrix is this way. Okay, that's why, you know, I have learned, you know, how to interpret those.
Yeah,
but usually when you see the confusion matrix in a diagram, you see your truths in the left and your false at the right, usually. But sometimes they are reversed. Okay, so yeah.
So
it's just to confuse you, you know? It's just like, it is a thing to confuse you, yeah.
Yeah, no, but it's fun because it's simple, but it's tricky at the same time.
Yeah, yeah, a little bit tricky. But if you check the true, you know, where are the true positives, okay? Those are associated with type one. The false, yeah. The false negatives, those are associated with the type two.
Yeah, okay.
I always think about that, you know, the analogy of innocent and found guilty. Okay, type one. Okay, innocent and found guilty.
yeah. In fact, but this is when you consider a priori that is innocent. Mm-hmm. Because otherwise
that's your null, okay? People are innocent until proven guilty, okay. Right? That's your null hypothesis. And where you are going to go through the process, the criminal process, is to see if you have enough evidence, okay? Enough, you know, the p-value, you know, it's really, really far. If you have enough evidence that tells you, hey, this guy is not innocent, he's guilty. Okay, uh-huh. So that's how the process works, but there are errors because, you know, that's how the system does.
Okay, so let's say it again. So when a new hypothesis is false and I do not reject the new hypothesis, I commit type two errors.
Type two error, excellent.
Okay. Yes.
That's right.
Because the null is false and I do not reject it, so I fail to reject the new hypothesis, and this is type two error. When the null hypothesis is true, mm-hmm. and I reject the null hypothesis, mm-hmm. this is type one error.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep. You got it.
Okay. So null hypothesis is true. While I reject the null hypothesis, so I reject the null hypothesis, but the null hypothesis is true, and I commit type one error, which is less somehow correct. Important than committing type two error. But still, there is a trade-off between type one and type two error to be put down somehow. The error rates. For these two type of errors. Okay, and, so now.
And last time we discussed that this, you know, when you set the alpha, right? The alpha, you're setting the threshold for the type one error, okay? That's your alpha, which is the threshold where the p-value, you're going to see if you reject or reject, okay? Because you never accept the new hypothesis, you reject. And that's the alpha. Then what happens to the beta? The beta is the threshold for the type two error. Uh-huh. So because you already have the alpha, the only way that you can, you know, decrease that beta, you know, the instances of the type two error is basically with the sample size. Okay, you need more larger sample, okay, to try to decrease that beta because you already fixed alpha already. That there's nothing that you can do now with beta, unless then, you know, you move alpha. If you move alpha a little bit larger, then your beta is going to decrease. Okay, mm-hmm. But then you have the type one error that is going to be, you know, more prone. Okay, sometimes you don't want that. Uh-huh. Okay, so that's why you have to fix the alpha, let's say to 0.05. Sometimes you have to fix it to 0.01, depending on the case. Okay, or 0.001. To make sure that when you reject, you have a very high significance level, okay, of confidence. But once you fix that, then your beta, you cannot do anything about it, okay? The only way that you can decrease it is sample size. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So now the family-wise error rate, it's a family of errors. So let's see, let's set M from 1 to 500, for example, and M is the number of p-value. So I start with a certain number of, let's see that M, I started with one M, M equals to one. So now I want to see what's happened if I have a certain number of p values. So the family wise error rate will be calculated.
Yeah, just to clarify, that M is right there, is the number of independent hypothesis tests.
Okay.
So in other words, that M is related to the number, the sample size, the number of events that you're going to create to try to test that, you know, error rate. Mm-hmm. Okay. So it's like a simulation, right? The same thing that you did with the p-values, with the 100, basically the same thing. Okay. Independent tests, depending on the, you know, on the distribution.
Okay. So now I'm calculating the error rate on three different thresholds, 5%, 1%, and 0.1%. So these are my new alpha. And I'm going to calculate this. This is the calculation for the family error rate for 5% alpha on M tries, basically. So I run this. And then we can see if we plot the result, we see that the three levels of alpha changes the result of the error rate. And it is a family error rate because we have a 1 to 500 cases to examine. So not just one. So it's a family error rate tested on three different levels of alpha. And we can see that for the different levels, here it's not this call, let's put this red and see what's happened. So this is red, this is blue, and this is green. Okay, so my family error rate one is 5%. We can see that this one, the red line, it's with alpha equals to 5%. This is the blue one is 1%. The green one is 0.1% threshold of alpha. So the greater is the threshold. So and basically we restrict our possibilities to locate our true value. The trend on a certain high number of tries shows that around 50 the level tend to be stable, ten to one to be stable. So you for sure, if you attempt to find a p-value which is lower than 5%, you find one. You'll be able to find one for sure after a certain number of times. So this is the point that we arrive talking about corrections. When we talk about the Bonferroni corrections and everything, for larger number of tries. Because if we set our threshold to 5%, after a certain number of tries, we for sure find at least, because we are talking about the probability to find at least one p-value, which is put us in the condition to reject the null hypothesis. So for this reason, when we have a certain high number of tries, we need to use a correction. And the correction, for example, will be using an alpha, which is calculated by alpha divided by m. So we restrict our alpha to a lower value, such as this green line, in a way that we need to have more tries before to reach, for sure, the probability to have at least one value, blah, blah, blah. Okay, so what do we do? No. We like to see what's happened if I think I'm going forward to see this Bonferroni correction, because I've already mentioned two things. So this function, p adjust, let's remind us a few things, give a set of p values. So it returns p values adjusted using one of the methods. Okay, so these are the values that we found, and we use the Bonferroni correction. So in this case, we can use a function p adjust and method specifying the method. We find something, but we can even, as you can see, calculate with this other function p mean, which is p mean, which returns the maximum and minimum of the input values. So the minimum input of our p values times 5, and 1 is the, what is it? So we can basically find the same result doing this way with the function p mean. So we find the minimum value within the p values that we found. 5 is basically the number of p values. It's our m in this case, because our p values are 5. So our m is the number of p values. So if we use this function, we can find the probability of finding at least one which is below the threshold. And if we do the mean of this result, we see that it's pretty high, so close to one. So we for sure found be able to find something. So to contrast this, and when we have an higher number of p-values to check within, because this happens when we have a large number of p-values, so the null hypothesis, and we want to summarize the result to find just the ones that are responding to our answers, okay? So we have other methods, yeah.
Federica, there's a comment there that you know, regarding the p-values, because those p-values correspond to the managers, right? We're comparing managers here, performance.
Yeah, for example. This
corresponds, these p-values correspond to each of the managers in the sequence, right? Manager number one, 0.03, manager number two, one, et cetera. So there's a comment here that says that using the Bonferroni method, the adjusted Bonferroni method, the only one that we can reject that null hypothesis, in other words, that the performance is different from the, you know, from the rest of them, is manager number one. Why? Because the p-value is less than 0.05, which is the alpha that we're using, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. And we're going to see that using another adjustment, the one that you are talking about, then we'll see that there could be a different result.
Yeah.
And basically the question is, which adjustment we should use?
Yeah.
Yeah, because you know, if they give you the same result, you should have any problem, right? You know, it doesn't matter the adjustment, but we'll see that with another adjustment, you get a different result. So the question is, which one am I going to use? You know, which one is the one that really gives me more confidence, okay? And I think that maybe there could be some, you know, some more statistical inference there. Try to see, you know, if they're maybe visually or, you know, in other tests to give you more information about that. Because sometimes you do that, you know, let's say, for example, if you do a t-test for X amount of samples, right? You know, for central t-test, and it gives you, okay, reject. Then in some other samples, it will give you, okay, no reject. So which one do you use? Maybe you need another type of test, okay, to try to get more information for your conclusion, okay?
Yeah. In fact, if we use the Holmes method, we found that two values are below the threshold now. So we are challenged now because which one? So we found the answer is always answered because we have found at least one. Now we found two. So what we can do is to calculate the mean of our result. Okay. And see that we still have some results as well. So
yeah, that's what I said, that sometimes when you get these conflicting results, sometimes you need to, you know, apply another type of technique to get more information. In this case, because you are comparing, you know, the deviation of each manager within the mean, okay, you see that manager one and manager three are really out, you know, they're about 3 points out of the mean or 2.8 out of the mean. And the other managers are very close, right? They're very close to the mean, which is zero here.
Yeah.
So now you get more information on the adjustment that it really is giving you the correct, you know, the correct, at least the correct statistical inference. Okay.
Mm-mm-mm. Okay. So basically I do the mean of my, this, where is it? This is my data set, which I have restricted to five managers. There were a certain number of managers, so restricted to five managers. By column, right? I do the mean, so of the results, and found that some means are lower, so decreasing, so lower than growing. So these are more than zeros, clearly, these two, and this other is negative. So there is a meaningful difference in performance between these managers, between these two, for example, or these other two, if we compare them in cover. So we can perform a paired t-test again to see if the a p-value it's still significant. So this is the p-value that we found running a t-test on this one and two, the first two managers. Yes. Okay, this is my one, no? My first column is this one here. So I'm comparing the first two managers, manager one and manager two, which they have completely different performance. One is very positive and one is negative. I run a t-test on these two and I do a pair t-test. The result is a p-value which is lower than 5%. So I can say that there is a difference. So it's statistically significant that there is a difference. So I reject the null hypothesis. So then if what's happened here, this is a specification, as I said last time, for a Furtad method. This is this 2K method that I didn't talk very much about that last time, because this is specific for the result when we sub-comparing. So from five manager, we now focus on two managers, found some result, and then we go forward applying other methods. And for example, if we, use this 2K method. This is a function as well. And create a set of confidence intervals on the difference between the means of the level of a factor with a specified family-wise probability of coverage. So it is a function in itself. So there is not a function Bonferroni, there is not for now, so we don't use it. We don't even use this as a method, but we use it separately. What it does, it takes consideration that it is a further, it's a secondary level analysis. Okay, but the book explained this these things. If we do 2K, there is even in the notes. Let's see. Ah, okay, just because I see better here. So the 2K HSD function provide confidence interval for the difference between each pair of managers. So the lower and the upper value, as well as a p-value. All of these quantities have been adjusted for multiple testing. And so the p-value for the difference between manager one and manager two has increased from the first p-value that we found, 0.38, to 0.1. So has increased from 0.38 to 1.186. So there is no longer clear evidence of a difference between the managers. performance. So we can plot a confidence interval to see what's happened. And this is 95 family-wise confidence level. So we see that this is the null level, so the zero level, and the variation from for this, because I'm comparing 1, 3, 1, 5, 2, 4, 3, 4, 5, 4. So I'm comparing these things.
Yeah, in the scale, it just shows you some of the pairs, but they are other pairs, okay? Because we have five, right? Five managers. So we're going to have one compared to two, one compared to three, one compared to four, one compared to five. And you keep doing that until you get the total number of pairs. The thing is that, you get it, but it doesn't show in the scale. That's a problem. This guy doesn't show it. Okay. So, as you can see, because all of these confidence intervals, cross zero. Okay. All of them show that they are not, statistically significant. Okay. Because there's a probability that mean difference in mean level for each comparison is zero. Okay, so if there's a probability, that means that you cannot reject the null hypothesis. Mm-hmm. The same way when we do the regression and you get a p-value less, more than 0.05, that means that coefficient in that predictor could be zero. Okay, and that's why you get that level is not significant enough to reject that null hypothesis. That is not, that it could be zero.
Yeah.
And that's all it means, really. Okay. It doesn't mean that with other analysis, for example, Bayesian analysis, you could get, a different result depending on the analysis, right? But here, the p-values, what we're trying to see is how significant. In other words, how far is that statistic away from that zero? Okay.
Yeah. So basically what we did it here is the analysis of variance on returns and manager. So this is A1, our model, which says that have a certain number of degrees of freedom. This is the analysis of variance, and the standard error is at a certain level. Then we apply on this analysis of variance D2K method. So we found the lower and the upper bound and the P adjustment. When we plot this result, so we plot this result, so the lower and the upper value and the P adjustment, so basically the difference between the second manager and the one manager is minus 3.1. The difference between the third manager, the first manager is minus 0.2. So these are the lower and the upper bound. And the P adjustment, it's the middle point, which is this one here. So we fit an ANOVA and then apply the ANOVA on the 2K method.
Okay, Federica, the middle point is the difference. Okay, that negative 3.1, if you go back to the chart.
Ah, it's the 3.1.
Can I go back to the chart?
Yeah, but where's the p-value?
Right here.
Yeah.
That's the middle point, which is the 3.1. And you get the confidence interval between, 95% between, you know, those ranges, right? Okay. And the p-value is calculated. It's calculated by this, you know, this statistic.
Okay, yes, of course, yes. So the p-value is around the zero.
Yeah. Exactly, but you won't see the p-value here because you need the distribution. Okay, you need that distribution.
Yeah.
You don't see that p-value, but because everyone crosses zero, you know already that the p-value is, you know, it giving you a value that is not statistically significant.
Uh-huh. Okay. Yeah.
Because they're all crossing zero. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yes. So now, for this, we do for the false discovery rate. But this p-value, this p-adjustment is the thing that then, define that there is no clear evidence of a difference between the manager's performance. So now this 0.186, it's from this column. It's the average of this column, I'm asking. Most probably. So if I do how can I extrapolate data from this 2K method? If I want just to the column of the p values, how can I do that? Well, anyway.
Check manager.
What?
Manager. Yeah. Put $ manager.
Manager.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. And now check if you can extract the p-value.
Okay.
Yeah. There you go.
So if I do the mean. No. If I do the mean.
Okay, but you're calculating here the mean of the p values, okay? Mm-hmm. Which is, it doesn't tell you that much. Okay, because you're calculating the mean of this, of all that p adjustments. Okay?
Yeah.
Maybe a more interesting would be try to associate the pairs with the p values. Okay, the pairs with the p-values to try to see where they are. Okay, within the alpha, the 0.05. Okay.
Mm-hmm. But where is this this p-value?
Right here, at the top. The top, right there, 0.186. That's the number.
Well, that's one for. Okay.
Yeah, because what he's doing is comparing the adjustment that we did with the, I think it was the home adjustment with the Tukey adjustment. That's what he's comparing. Okay. Because that 0.038 comes from a different adjustment.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay. Now I understand.
Yeah.
So
basically, right there. Yeah.
So basically, that's the 2K things. So, I had five managers. Now I restrict to two managers, apply a t-test, find a p-value, and then run a 2K on all five.
Right.
But then grab So select the p-value corresponding to the cover that I was checking on.
Exactly. You are pinpointing that one, that perimpatine, which is the first two managers, the 2-1, the 1-2 of two managers. And it gives you a p-adjustment of 0.1x6 that is bigger, much bigger than the 0.038 that you calculated before.
Okay.
And what it's doing is comparing. You know, one of them says that reject the null hypothesis, in other words, there's a difference, and the other one says, there's no difference.
okay. Great, thank you. Okay, let's go forward. So we did that. Now we are going to check the false discovery rate. Let's see if we can have a look at this better. So now we perform hypothesis testing for 2000 fund managers, and we perform a t-test with a null hypothesis, which says that there is no difference in the performance of these managers. Again, set up a vector of 2000, and fill up the vector with the p-values of a t-test for each one. So there are too many managers to consider trying to control the family-wise error rate. So there are too many managers. So we focus on controlling the error. So we for sure make some That would be not very precise, not precise. So we now control we want to control the error. So the expected fraction of rejected null hypotheses that are actually false positive. So we use the p-adjust function with the method Benjamin Hochberg. So the p-adjust on the vector that we have just filled up with all the p-values from the t-test with the method. So this method, if we calculate by hand, does alpha divided by m as a threshold using alpha divided by hand. So these q values are the output for this new method, Benjamin Hochberg procedure. And it is the smallest FDR threshold which we would reject the null hypothesis for. So if, for example, extrapolate a Q value, this is not a P value now, it's a Q value of 0.1. So this indicates that we are going to reject all the null hypotheses that going out of this threshold, so are greater than this 10%. But we cannot reject the null hypotheses that are below 10%. So we do this by summing up all the Q values that are lower than 10%. Then we do this alpha, this new alpha, divided by m, which is now 2000. And we see that the sum is zero. So now this is the tricky part. Okay. Basically, the false discovery rate, okay, so we have made this fund p-values, okay. Now it's filled up with the result of a t-test, okay, with the p-values. With the function p-adjust, and the method Benjamin Hochberg, we can find the Q values They are not p-values now, they are q-values. For example, selecting from 1 to 10, we have these values. Yeah. So now, basically, we have restricted threshold, making bigger, because now it's 10% instead of 5%, as alpha usually is. To see, so basically now we are going to the right, to the left with the line. We are going to the left, so we have a smaller area to identify our values. So now we put them on order. M is the number of p values. Q, which is our new alpha, is now set on 10%. It's a p value. Yes, it's a now it's a q value. Okay, yes. It's always a sort of alpha, no? Because we check the p-value against an alpha, which is 5%. So now we are checking our p-value against a q-value, which is 10% instead of 5. And this says which of our p-values are lower than 10% times, so basically we are dividing this new q-value divided by m. Where I've seen this, there is a nice, I put this, there is a nice course on edX. I don't know if you have seen it, where they tell you about these things. And what you can see, and there is a nice explanation about these things. Maybe I put the information directly on chat, on Slack later, because I have some information about the course, which is very interesting. And you can see how to make the calculation manually without using a function which is already made. So now, what do we do? We have set a new threshold, which is now a Q value. Okay, and we basically select our p-values against this 10%, okay? And then again, divide this 10% by 2000, which is the number of p-values, to restrict again this threshold. And so what we found is that if we compare the three result, the result with the two methods, we see that just a certain number of values are below our new threshold, while others are still aside. Yeah, looking at the at this function, maybe it's a bit like tricky to see. But
Federica, I think we are past the hour.
Yeah. Okay. So we still have a few things to if we want to go through these things. Otherwise, we can.
I mean, there's not that much left. Okay, I think this is the final lab.
Mm-mm.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let me see if there's something else.
No, the last.
Yeah, this is the last thing. Uh-uh. I don't know if you want to, you know, meet next week and just discuss it and that's it, you know, wrap it up.
Yeah, I think so, because it, for me, this part is very important. So I need to really understand what's happened. Yeah. So maybe we can keep forward for another week.
So correct.
We revisit the
things. Also, I could show there's an episode from Julia's blog, Julia Silgi's blog. She did some statistical inference using tidy models. Since we don't have that chapter, it's still in progress in Emil's blog. Maybe I can check that because, you know, it was very interesting. It was about the Tuskegee Airmen. And she used certain functions that are in the tidy models, which, you know, could be useful for simplifying a little bit the coding, because I know that our base R is not that intuitive, okay, and the tidy models try to, you know, make it a little more a little bit simpler and also kind of, you know, coding friendly. Code friendly.
Okay. Yeah.
So we could do that and then wrap it up.
Right. If you can put that on Slack.
Sure.
Yeah. So I'll have a look at that and then I put the other things about
it. Because when we meet again, then we could put it in the chat and it stays in the chat log. Okay.
Okay. Great.
Okay. So, arrivederci.
And arrivederci.
Get, you know, get, an air condi- get a big fan, air conditioning, you know, somewhere. Yeah. Go to the shopping and get some, you know, cool air.
Thank you.
Okay, see you next week. Take care.
Bye.
Okay. Bye. Bye-bye.